to do away with effective checks and balances under a tripartite government system. Under the pretext that the Chief Justice and the Supreme Court are impediments to reforms sought by him, the President aims to remove the Chief Justice and make the Supreme Court subservient to his whims. It is our fervent hope that the Senate will not lend its assistance to this plot. Let not this institution allow the guillotine to fall on the judicial independence. During the time of U.S. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, a similar situation occurred. After being repeatedly rebuked by the Supreme Court, a peeved President Roosevelt wanted to undermine and control the judiciary by seeking to create additional positions in the U.S. Supreme Court so that he could appoint a majority of the members. In refusing to pass the amendment, the U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee wrote in its report, and I quote, "Let us, of the 75th Congress, in words that will never be disregarded by any succeeding Congress, declare that we would rather have an independent court, a fearless court, a court that will dare to announce its honest opinions in what it believes to be the defense of the liberties of the people, than a court that out of fear or sense of obligation to the appointing power or factional passion approve any measure we may enact. We are not the judges of the judges." Finally, the case of the Chief Justice is not complete without reference to the fundamental right to the presumption of innocence. We have seen the absolute lack of any damning evidence presented against the Chief Justice, even where it was alleged by the prosecution that his acts are punishable violations. The defense has shown that the Chief Justice relied on sound legal basis for his position, and in all instances guided by good faith and without malice. But beyond what the prosecution failed to prove, what strengthens the presumption of innocence is the credibility of the Chief Justice in giving justice, in proving himself forthright, courageous, and true. His innocence is buttressed by the common sense truth behind his testimony, affirming the experience of many Filipinos in their own families. His courage is shown by his dauntless determination to fight this impeachment and the horrid cesspool of propaganda along with it. Most of all, he has responded to the call of the Filipino people by defying all expectations and raising the bar for all public officials. Despite his reliance on the confidentiality of RA 6426, the Chief Justice has, upon the request of the Senate, waived the confidentiality of his bank accounts, thereby setting the standard of transparency in public service. Indeed, the innocence of the Chief Justice arises not only from the abject lack of evidence against him, but from his conduct, wholly consistent with a clear conscience. Truly, Your Honors, you are called upon to judge a man who has proven why he is the Chief Justice. After I speak, the prosecution will lace your ears with the last lines or even the last paragraphs, but their courtship shall be in vain. For borrowing the words of the counsel of President Clinton, theirs will not be the last voice, because the voice I will leave with you is the voice of reason, the voice of the law, and the voice of truth, the voice that will ring forever in your conscience. Your Honors, the other defense counsels and I respectfully request that you render a verdict of acquittal.
Thank you. Majority floor leader.
The prosecution may continue. They have 40 minutes left.
Mr. President, before the second speaker for the prosecution speaks, may we request for 1 minute recess just to allow us to set up the PowerPoint.
Okay.
Presentation.
1 minute recess.
All right, we just heard the closing argument started by, it was opened by the prosecution, lead prosecutor Niel Tupas, going back into history, mentioning magistrates, former Supreme Court justices, specifically one of those that even declined midnight appointment, more appealing to the emotion compared to that of defense counsel de Los Angeles, whose closing argument was more methodical in nature, more rational, so to speak. Dean, perhaps you'd be more fitting to describe both closing arguments, since you've seen this in court quite often.
Well, as you correctly pointed out, Karen, the closing argument of Niel Tupas appeals both to the intellect and the emotion. The one of Dean de Los Angeles is scholarly, cerebral, no? And harps mainly on points of law. Well, one thing, however, that was not covered, well, as expected,